on that one. Can I see them? Your iPad, your Bible, set them on this. Because the great man of God is in our midst, and I want everybody to benefit. Today we are going to touch the anointing that is in him.
Amen.
Before he leave here, we take everything. You need to go and prepare yourself for Andrew. Hallelujah. Amen. Yes, I want to see your Bibles and your tablet. God bless you. God bless you. Hallelujah. Amen. You people are grand soldiers of God. You are fully prepared. It's an opportunity to introduce to you our dear elder and the entire family. Hallelujah.
Amen.
This shows to me that he's so happy to come to Andrew, to turn out. He came with the whole house. We have our dear brother Emmanuel. Thank you for having us. We have our dear Jeffrey. We have the little girl, Ariella. And also, I have our baby. I don't know whether it's our baby last or still it's in the way. Hallelujah. God has blessed this church. I'm sure you are going to be blessed today.
Amen.
We have our baby, Christabel. As I told you that the whole house is here, we have our dear Mama Deaconess Grace Ushu. The better half of our speaker today. And shall we all with clap offering invite our dear elder Andrew to
joy in me. Amen.
Amen.
And I thank God I'm here. Today is a very great and wonderful day. It's above all the Lord's Supper. So as my sister sang the song, he said, he paid a debt that I did not owe, and I owe a debt that I could not pay. I needed someone to wash away my sins. Now I can sing a brand new song, Amazing Grace. Amazing Grace. You and I, we had a debt that we couldn't pay. The wonderful thing about this debt is that it is not you who caused it. I didn't cause it. I did not even know how it came about that I had a debt to pay. But the word of God said, my grandfather, great grandfather, great, 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 super great grandfather, what was his name?
Adam.
Who?
Adam.
He caused the debt. And through all generations, we owe the same debt. And that debt could only be paid by life. It's a life sentence, so we take your life for that. But Jesus said, you know what, God? You are right. You know, God is a God. When he speaks, he can't take back his word. His word remains the same. So you say one thing, I'll go and pay the debt. So Jesus came and died so that you and I could be free. Let's give Jesus a clap. Already, so I'm not going to pray again, and I know the Spirit is here. Amen.
Amen.
Anytime I stand, I tell God, God, you have given me so many gifts. Sometimes you use me to prophesy, sometimes you use me to preach, sometimes to teach, sometimes to heal the sick. But Lord, today, whatever that you want to use me for, I am ready.
Amen.
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 I know before I leave here, somebody is going to be a blessing.
Amen.
It's going to be you. Amen.
Amen.
The whole nation, we have been given a theme, hearing and obeying the voice of God in my generation. We know this one. Hearing and obeying
the voice of God in my generation.
Thank you. Where is it taking from? Which book he's taking from? Eh? Try. Uh-huh. Apostle would never give a theme without giving the quotation. So somebody help me. Hearing. Who was a boy in the Bible who heard the word of God? Who heard God's voice?
Samuel.
Good. So where is he taking from?
Samuel.
First or second Samuel?
First
Samuel. Chapter. Verses. Read the Bible sometimes, yo. First Samuel chapter 3, verses 1 to 10. Because of time, I'm going to make the story short. Who was the father, the mother of Samuel? Hannah. Okay, I'm going to make it the teaching way so that you flow with me, okay? I won't preach, but I'll teach. Amen. Who was the mother of Samuel?
Hannah.
Good. Why did Hannah dedicate his son? Imagine you were looking for something, you can't have it. And now you have one, we say, God, take it. It's kind of weird, isn't it? Will you do that?
No.
Will you? You say, you know, okay, I will do it. Not doing it from my heart. But Hannah did it. Hannah dedicated her only son unto God. Because why? She made a vow. Say, God, if you give me one, I'll bring the child back unto you. Right? I paraphrase it. So the Bible says, when the time came, God answered a prayer. May God answer your prayer today.
Amen.
And Hannah conceived, and he gave birth to a bouncing baby boy. And after the child was weaned, the Bible says she went back with her husband to Shiloh and told Eli, this is the baby that I asked God for. And he gave Samuel back unto the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
I don't know what you have today to give to God. But anything that you give back unto God, he gives you something marvelous back unto you. Yeah. Amen.
Amen.
This woman we call Hannah, she was barren. She couldn't get kids. But when she gave one to God, God gave more than four or five children, even back more. Isn't that wonderful? Yeah. Peter, the turn out. What do you have to give to God? It might not be money, it might not be your children, but this dispensation, God needs your time. Give God your time. If you give God your time, you give him much more things that you need. Who knows the most valuable currency on earth? Is it pounds, euros, dollars, or fault? The most valuable currency on earth is time. Take it from me. When you go to UK, you spend your pounds when you are coming, you leave it there. Even when you take your pounds to Ghana, you change it to what? Cedis. The value is gone. But the same time you take from here to Ghana, the same time you spend, you don't change it. 24 hours, 24 hours. The baby there has the same 24 hours. Me standing here, 24 hours. Elder, 24 hours. And you too, 24 hours. Every single day, God deposits 24 hours in your bank accounts. Say, use it. You use the whole 24 hours, and the rest that you couldn't use, it's gone. The following day, you give another 24 hours again. But how do you use your time? Amen.
Amen.
Don't forget, the theme is, hearing and obeying the voice of God in my generation. Amen.
Amen.
But the question is, if I don't hear, how can I obey? Someone was in the temple and he heard someone. We take your Bible and let's open to 1 Samuel chapter 3. And as you look into the scriptures, I'll be just going along with it so that you flow with me because of time. He heard God, Samuel. The Bible says he rose up and then he went to Eli and said, here am I, because you called me. So I didn't call you. The young boy came back again and slept. The voice came again, Samuel. He woke up the second time and went. Say, Master, here I am, you called me. And then he went back and slept, the Bible says. But Eli perceived that it was God who was calling him. What I'm saying is in the Bible, I'm not reading mine. I have mine in my head. So you look into yours. But the Bible says, Eli perceived that it was God who was calling him. So he told him, when the voice come again, say it what?
Speak.
Sorry?
Speak.
What you're telling me might not be different from what is in the Bible, right? He said, when the voice come again, what should you say?
Speak, Lord.
That word Lord is what I want to hear. Speak, Lord, for your servant is what? Listening. That word Lord means owner. That's why we say landlord, the owner of the house. Lord means owner. The moment you confess Jesus as your Lord, he becomes your owner. You agree with me?
Yes.
Therefore, when your master speaks, you must be able to hear. But what happens if you can't hear your master's voice? Jesus said, I know my sheep know me. And when my sheep cry, do you belong to God?
Yes.
The yes is weak. That means you are not sure.
Yes.
Pia, do you belong to God?
Yes.
Do you belong to God?
Yes.
Good. My question is, in how many ways does God speak to us? So many ways. Name one.
In our dreams,
thank you. Two.
Prophecy.
Two prophecy. Three. Through the word of God.
By
visions. By visions, dreams. Okay. By revelations. Revelations, dreams, visions, they come all together as one. Through people, I like it. Through me, like for example. Only two more that I need to hear. Two more. Only two.
By signs.
By signs and thank you. One more. And also through nature. No. God does not speak to you through. He doesn't pray to you. You pray to him. Last one. Last one. It's because of that person this table has been set.
Through
Jesus Christ. Amen. So if you don't know these ways, it will be hard for you to see that, hey, is God speaking to me? Amen. Most at times, we have dreams and the next morning we forget it. Some time ago, I was doing some studies and the lecturer said, if you really want to know God speaking to you, take a pen and a paper or a notebook by your side of the bed. And when you're going to sleep, say, God, I'm going to sleep. I want to see you tonight. Come and speak to me, Lord. I want to hear. The moment you wake up, take that pen and write whatever that you see in the dreams. I did it for a week and two. And I tell you, what I hear and what I know is too much. So God speaks. And now he still speaks.
Amen.
But if you don't hear, how can you obey? Hearing is one part, and obeying is another. Amen.
Amen.
I don't know which part you are taking today. But as for me, I'm taking both. I want to hear, and I also want to obey. In the book of Genesis chapter 1 verse 27, the Bible says, God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them. It's in your Bible. In Genesis chapter 2 verse 27, the Bible said, then God formed man from the dust of the earth. So here if you don't take it, you might think God created two human beings in the beginning. Genesis chapter 1 verse 27, the Bible says, God created man in his own image. But when you read chapter 2 verse 27, the Bible says, he formed man from the dust. What does this mean? The word create in your Bible, Genesis 1 26, in the Hebrew word is bara. Bara means to make something out of nothing. Okay? Genesis chapter 2 verse 27 says, he formed. That means he takes something out of something and made it. So you sitting here, you have two parts. Your spirit and your flesh. You get that? The first one said he created man in his own image. Okay? Right now in case, for example, my wife is pregnant and you ask me, what are you getting? and I say, oh, I'm getting my image, what do you think the child is going to be? A boy, of course. So for me to know what kind of man that God made in Genesis chapter 1, verse 20 says, I must know who God is. Right? Because you cannot put something square under a photocopy machine, and when you make a copy, it becomes round. It's not possible. The image is what you have. Let's go to John chapter 4, verse 24. Jesus said, a time has come, and now is, that the true worshippers of God must worship God in truth and in spirit, because God is what?
Spirit.
Thank you. So the image, you know, I'm not looking at the Bible, eh? When you go home, do your homework on that. Now, so that means that me standing here, I have God's image. That is His spirit inside of me. So, right now, let me give this one illustration. Imagine you are in the farm or in a forest, and our parents are somewhere else. And then by playing, we drift away from them and we are lost. And your father shouts, maybe we are three or five boys around. Kwekwe! One of us who is Kwekwe will feel it inside. Heard that talk? When back in the village, we all speak tree here, right? We say, Yakase, watu hoo. You hear the sound. So when your father shouts your name, Kwekwe! No matter how far you are, you hear your name, you are always feeling something inside. It's true. That's how God is. So if you have God's image, that means God's spirit in you, you become connected with Him.
Amen.
You understand? That's why Romans says, the spirit itself bears witness that we are the children of God. So if you don't have God's spirit, the Bible says you are none of His. So,